Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come into God's presence with singing. Know that the Lord is God. It is He that made us, and we are His. We are His people and the sheep of His pasture. Enter His gates with thanksgiving and His courts with praise. Give thanks to Him. Bless His name, for the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and His faithfulness to all generations. Let us worship the Lord our God this day. Welcome to this service of worship with the St. Andrew's Church community, and thank you for taking the time to join us today. We hope that this time will be meaningful and helpful for you in your life and in your journey of faith. A few announcements about activities at St. Andrew's as we begin. As those who were able to join us in person at the service last week will know, we celebrated the annual Act of Remembrance with the 48th Highlander Regiment of Canada, which has been connected with the congregation since the regiment's formation in 1891. This annual commemoration includes the turning of a page in the Book of Remembrance that is found at the end of the communion table. The communion table itself was actually a gift to the church from the sergeants in the 48th Highlanders, and recorded in the Book of Remembrance are the names of everyone from that regiment who has fallen in active duty since the beginning of the regiment. It is always a meaningful time with the regiment, and we were very thankful to have them with us. We thought it might be nice to share some of the photos that were taken last week, including from the parade that begins at the church after the service concludes and parades across the city of Toronto to the Moss Park Armory, where the 48th Highlanders is headquartered. Many of the congregation's regular activities have now resumed after the COVID closures, and you're welcome to visit the church website at www.standrewstoronto.org to find out ways to be involved in the life of this congregation. At the end of today's online service, we hope that you will enjoy a short excerpt from the recorded Friday noontime recital that took place on April the 22nd, 2022. It featured Kathy Wang on piano and Ismael Guerrero Bambut on cello. It was a beautiful recital, and we hope that you enjoy this excerpt. If you want to see the full recital, it can be found on the church website. On Thursday, May 5th, we're going to be having a special evening for those who might be interested in considering becoming members of this congregation. If you would like more information about that, please email the church office at info@standrewstoronto.org. Finally, we're looking forward to the next speaker series event, which is going to take place in the Great Hall of the church on Thursday, May the 12th, beginning at 7 o'clock p.m. It's going to be a fascinating evening. And we will be joined by John Brzezinski, who will share about his experience of being part of a project that located and raised from the bottom of Lake Ontario parts from the models of the Avro Arrow. More information can be found on the church website, and I would strongly encourage you to consider joining us for the evening. It is going to be a really intriguing time together. But for now, we hope that you will enjoy this time of worship. May the peace of the risen Christ indeed be with each one of you.
Let us come before God in prayer. Let us pray. God of the risen Christ and of the rising sun, we come before you this day, giving thanks for all the wonder in your creation, for the tiny perfection revealed in a baby's fingers grasping ours, in each daffodil unzipping its jacket to greet the spring, and each rock face worn by wind and water bearing its rugged beauty with your praise. These details lift our hearts to praise you too. So let the details of the story of the risen Christ lift our hearts this day, that we may greet a new week as an occasion to discover Christ in our midst, making all things new with the springtime of your Spirit. God of each and every life, week by week we lay our lives before you, acknowledging the ways in which we fall short of your hope for us. Today we confess that we sometimes find it hard to forgive ourselves. Things done long ago still haunt us. We hear your forgiveness proclaimed, yet your promise of a fresh start can ring hollow. Forgive us if we think we are the one sinner who cannot be forgiven. Forgive us when we cannot find the peace you offer. And hear us now as we continue in our confession in the silence of our hearts. Friends in Christ, while it is true we have fallen short of God's intentions, it is greater truth that we are forgiven through God's love in Jesus Christ. To all who humbly seek the mercy of God, Jesus offers forgiveness and new life. So be at peace with God, with yourself, and with one another. O God of sight and insight, send your Holy Spirit to remove the scales from our eyes, so that we might see your truth and grasp your wisdom. Grant us fresh understanding of your word and your will for our lives. We pray in the name of the one who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
Meanwhile, Saul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues at Damascus, so that if he found any who belonged to the way, men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. Now as he was going along and approaching Damascus, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? He asked, Who are you, Lord? The reply came, I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. But get up and enter the city, and you will be told what you are to do. Today's psalm is Psalm 30. I will extol you, O Lord, for you have drawn me up, and did not let my foes rejoice over me. O Lord my God, I cried to you for help, and you have healed me. O Lord, you brought up my soul from Sheol, restored me to life from among those gone down to the pit. Sing praises to the Lord, O you faithful ones, and give thanks to God's holy name. For the Lord's anger is but for a moment. The Lord's favor is for a lifetime. Weeping may linger for the night, but joy comes with the morning. As for me, I said in my prosperity, I shall never be moved. By your favor, O Lord, you had established me as a strong mountain. You hid your face, I was dismayed. To you, O Lord, I cried, and to the Lord I made supplication. What profit is there in my death, if I go down to the pit? Will the dust praise you? Will it tell of your faithfulness? Hear, O Lord, and be gracious to me. O Lord, be my helper. You have turned my mourning into dancing. You have taken off my sackcloth and clothed me with joy, so that my soul may praise you and not be silent. O Lord my God, I will give thanks to you forever. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. The reading from the Gospel today is from the Gospel of John, chapter 21, verses 1 to 19. After these things, Jesus showed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias, and he showed himself in this way. Gathered there together were Simon Peter, Thomas, called the Twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two others of his disciples. Simon Peter said to them, I am going fishing. They said to him, We will go with you. They went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Just after daybreak, Jesus stood on the beach, but the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to them, Children, you have no fish, have you? They answered him, No. He said to them, Cast the net to the right side of the boat, and you will find some. So they cast it, and now they were not able to haul it in because there were so many fish. That disciple, whom Jesus loved, said to Peter, It is the Lord. When Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on some clothes, for he was naked, and he jumped into the lake. But the other disciples came in the boat, dragging the net full of fish, for they were not far from the land, only about 100 yards off. When they had gone ashore, they saw a charcoal fire there, with fish on it, and bread. Jesus said to them, Bring some of the fish that you have just caught. So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore, full of large fish, 153 of them. And though there were so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, Come and have breakfast. Now none of the disciples dared to ask him, Who are you? Because they knew it was the Lord. Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them, and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time that Jesus appeared to the disciples, after he was raised from the dead. When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? He said to him, Yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Jesus said to him, Feed my lambs. A second time he said to him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? He said to him, Yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Jesus said to him, Tend my sheep. He said to him the third time, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter felt hurt because he said to him the third time, Do you love me? And he said to him, Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you. Jesus said to him, Feed my sheep. Very truly, I tell you, when you were younger, you used to fasten your own belt and to go wherever you wished. But when you grow old, you will stretch out your hands, and someone else will fasten a belt around you and take you where you do not wish to go. He said this to indicate the kind of death by which he would glorify God. After this, he said to him, "Follow me." This is the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
So to begin with a question for you, what did Jesus do at his last recorded meal with his disciples? If most of us were asked that question, we would likely begin to speak about the night before Jesus was betrayed and crucified. When he stooped down to wash the feet of his disciples, he told them how much he loved them and shared bread and wine with them and asked them to continue to do so, to remember him and what he was doing for them and for this world. There's good reason why our thoughts would go in that direction towards the Last Supper. After all, the Last Supper is the origin of our communion sacrament. And on a regular basis, we gather together as the church and reread and retell and remember what Jesus did at that Last Supper with his friends. And yet, as today's reading reminds us, the Last Supper was not actually the last recorded meal that Jesus celebrated with his friends. Rather, after he rose from the dead, he also had breakfast with them. As we journey through this Easter season, these weeks following Easter Sunday, the lectionary invites us to read stories of Jesus' post-resurrection appearances. These appearances that he had to his disciples and friends and followers after he rose from the dead. Last week we read about the interactions between Jesus and his fearful disciples and the character who has come to be known as Doubting Thomas. Today's reading from Acts recounts a dramatic and life-changing encounter between Saul, who had been a persecutor of the early church, and a vision of the risen Jesus before Saul's name was changed to Paul and before he went on to become the Christian history's greatest author and missionary and theologian. And today, the suggested gospel reading invites us to turn our attention to another one of those post-resurrection appearances, as we turn our attention to a little scene that's set early one morning on a beach. As the passage opens, it becomes clear that the disciples did not really seem to know what to do with themselves. They had seen the empty tomb and encountered the risen Christ. Even Thomas, who had originally questioned the veracity of his friend's claims, had himself seen Jesus. But in light of all those strange events, in light of all that had happened, what were they supposed to do? It would undoubtedly have been a confusing time. And so in the midst of the perplexity, they did what fishermen do. They went fishing. In verse 3 of today's reading, we read, "Simon Peter said to them, 'I'm going fishing.' They said to him, 'We will go with you.'" Often when this passage is read, there is a wise, faithful, and beloved member of our church congregation who mentions to me just how much he enjoys the dynamics of this scene in light of how human and really how wise Simon Peter's reaction to the situation happened to be. That is, in the midst of the challenges and uncertainties and emotions that the disciples were going through, Simon Peter had the presence of mind to suggest that perhaps the wisest thing for them to do was to get on with doing what they knew how to do. So often in moments of crisis and loss and grief and uncertainty and confusion in life, we can become paralyzed. We can become uncertain what to do with ourselves. And sometimes just doing what we know how to do is exactly the best way through those difficult times. And those old disciples, they were fishermen first. And so they did what fishermen do. They went fishing. Unfortunately, the fishing expedition was not particularly successful. But then in verse 4, we read, "Just after daybreak, Jesus stood on the beach, but the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus gave the fishermen strange instructions to cast their nets to the other side of the boat, which they did, resulting in a large catch of fish." Realizing who it was that had given those instructions, Peter jumped out into the sea and the other disciples rowed the boat to shore. And then as they pulled onto shore and gathered together with their risen friend, they shared another meal together. But no longer was it bread and wine in the depths and darkness of the evening hours. Rather, in verse 9 we read, when they had gone ashore, they saw a charcoal fire there with fish on it and bread. Jesus told them to bring some of the fish that they had just caught. They did, and in verse 12, Jesus invites them to share a meal with him. Come and have breakfast. Come and have breakfast. Those who had shared the Last Supper with him before his crucifixion were now being invited to this, the first recorded post-resurrection meal. Come and have breakfast. And in this, there's plenty to ponder, plenty of pause for reflection, even today. Consider, after all, how different the typical dynamics are between supper and breakfast. Supper, well, it's eaten at the end of the day. The day's work is finished, the darkness is setting in, and soon the night will be upon us. In many ways, the conversations at supper, at dinner, about what has passed by us already, the events and conversations that we've experienced in the previous day, the accomplishments and perhaps the frustrations that we've had, the people that we've spent time with. Often when I share dinner with Leslie and the kids, I find myself asking the same question that my dad used to ask me. How was your day? How was school? How was work? And whether we have kids or not, the most common dinner time questions are usually oriented to the past, to what has happened, to what has been done in the day that is now drawing to a close. Even when we do not share a meal with friends or family members, dinner is usually a time when we find ourselves thinking about what has occupied our time and our attention over the course of the day that is drawing to a close. In many ways, these dinner time dynamics are at the heart of what happened at the Last Supper. In many ways, our reflections and remembering of what happened at that Last Supper, well, they're all focused on the past. The night was closing in, both literally and figuratively in the gospel text. Darkness was about to descend upon Jesus and upon the disciples. Jesus' work of teaching and healing and instructing the disciples were now finished behind them. They were past. He knew what Judas had already done to set him up for betrayal and for arrest. He told them to remember him and to remember the things that he had taught them and to remember the things that they had shown him throughout the course of their past times together. That last dinner, that last meal, that last supper was shared as time was drawing to a close. But breakfast. Breakfast, on the other hand, is usually marked by a very different set of dynamics. Again, consider what usually happens at breakfast. By the time that we do drag ourselves out of bed and have our first cup of coffee and join someone at breakfast, the night has come and gone. The light has once again prevailed over and risen above the darkness. The sun has come up. The day has begun. And what do we often speak about at breakfast if we do share that meal with someone else? The essential orientation of a breakfast conversation is usually towards the future, not to the past. Not how was your day, but what are you going to do today? What plans do you have? What are your hopes for the day? What do you want to accomplish as this coming day begins? And it's for that reason that I think that this other meal, this first breakfast, this first post-resurrection recorded meal might have something profoundly important to teach us even today. Because even though the Last Supper invites us to remember what Jesus did for us so long ago, this breakfast scene is very much about the future. No longer was the focus on what Christ had done for the disciples, but rather now the focus is what the disciples, and Peter in particular, were being asked to do for Christ. His risen presence assured them that morning that the night was now past. The sun had risen. A new day had begun. The powers of sin and death had been broken. Their failure, their abandonment, their betrayal, their denial were now over and done with. They were forgiven. They and the world had been reborn. His last recorded meal with them shifted their gaze from the past and now to the future, the beginning of a new day. As such, Jesus had breakfast kind of questions for Peter. In light of this new day that's dawning, this new life that I'm giving to you, What are your plans? If you say you love me, how are you going to demonstrate that stated devotion? What are your intentions, your hopes, your dreams for the day, for the life that now lies before you? And when Peter asserted his love for his friend, Jesus invited him to demonstrate that love in the future, in the care that Peter offered to others. Feed my lambs, tend my sheep, care for others, live with compassion, demonstrate your devotion to me, the living Christ, through your love for others. In other words, as this new day dawns, what acts of compassion are you going to perform, Peter? How are you going to love and serve others? How are you going to put your faith into action? How are you going to encourage and inspire faith and hope and love in the hearts and minds of those around you? It's fascinating for us to contemplate the ways that the disciples responded to these questions. That is, before Jesus' invitation to them to join him for breakfast, they had, as we noted already, they'd just gone fishing. They had, in other words, fallen back into their comfortable old routines, their usual practices, their normal daily activities. But after that breakfast on that beach that morning, there is no record in the biblical accounts that those fishermen ever went fishing again. In fact, instead, after that breakfast, they went out and changed the world. And it is the same dynamic that encourages us and inspires us and engages us in this Easter season. The resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead invites us not only to remember his broken body and shed blood, as he invited his friends to do on his last supper with them. Rather, the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead also invites us to look to the future of our lives, to the future of the church, to the future of the world, with a breakfast question on our lips. And it was this on that beach so long ago, and it is this even today. In light of what has happened, in light of this new life, this new day that now lies before you because of what I have done on the cross and in the empty tomb, in light of the resurrection, what are you going to do today?
Let us confess our faith today in the ancient words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us continue in our worship as we bring our prayers to Almighty God. Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, we draw near to you in prayer this day, trusting that your love does change lives and that your resurrection does bring renewal and redemption into the world God loves. As we lay before you the concerns on our hearts today, we pray that you will draw near to the people and situations we name and bring each one the gift that is needed. We lay before you, Lord, the concerns we share from the news headlines and the many world situations where hope and change are desperately needed. We pray especially for those caught up in the conflict in Ukraine that we hear about daily, and also for those in Afghanistan, Syria, Yemen, Sudan, and elsewhere that we do not hear so much about. We lay before you, Lord, those who are in hospital, and all those who struggle with illness, pain, or health burdens of any sort, those who are in long-term care, and those who face their challenges on the streets of our city. We remember those facing grief and loss, bearing burdens of sorrow and worry. We lay before you, Lord, families under stress, relationships that are strained, friends and neighbors in need of reconciliation. And we pray for the healing of divisions in our country and in our city. As we prepare ourselves for the provincial election, help us to listen to the needs of the most vulnerable among us and what each candidate offers to bring comfort, hope, and justice. Inspire each candidate to seek the common good in their calling to serve in public life. We lay before you, Lord, the earth itself, struggling in so many places to maintain its fruitfulness. And we pray for all the vulnerable creatures and communities who are finding it harder and harder to live on land, sea, or sky. Help us to find ways to reduce our harmful impact on all our relations in creation and to seek a sustainable future to the seventh generation. Lord Jesus, we believe that you hear our prayers and will be faithful to our requests and concerns. Use us in every opportunity that presents itself to serve you by serving our neighbors, near and far. Receive our heartfelt prayers, O God, Creator, Christ, and Spirit, ever three and ever one, now and forevermore. Amen.
And now may the love of Almighty God, the grace of our risen Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and the comfort and friendship of God's Holy Spirit dwell with you and those you love this day and forevermore. Amen.
Mm-hmm.